Josh, the big question going into the presser was what's going to happen with Kawhi. I mean, what do you think has to play out here? He knows the city. Is he just got to talk to the Clippers? Does he have to talk to Uncle Dennis? I mean, what do you think plays out here where he's going to make a decision whether he comes back or not?
Oh, I would be really surprised if this takes more than a few days, and that might even be too much considering what would Kawhi have to do at this point?
Josh, do you think he knows what he's going to do already, or is there...
I think he does. I mean, why wouldn't he at this point? I think we have a pretty good idea of what the reasons would be why he would stay. The money, the chance to win a championship, the mutual trust that they've built here. And I think he has a pretty good idea of why he would leave, specifically to go to the Clippers. Those seem like the two teams in play here. If you're going to go to the Clippers, it's going to be because you want to play close to home, maybe the warm climate and all of that. I think the factors are pretty clear. They've been pretty clear for a while now. Maybe he takes a few meetings, but what are the Clippers going to tell him in this meeting? What are the Raptors going to say in this meeting that changes his mind? I think he has a pretty good idea of what he's going to do. And even if he doesn't, at least he has the information to work with already. To me, he doesn't seem like a guy that needs to be or wants to be wooed. I think if the Raptors or the Clippers or any team goes in there and puts on an elaborate presentation, PowerPoint, videos, special guests, like that's just going to do them a disservice, I think. So I don't see this bleeding into the middle of July or even July 5th, 6th, the end of the moratorium. I think this is going to be settled within the first few days and we're going to know. But the biggest takeaway today in terms of the Kawhi stuff from Masai is that, and this isn't a huge surprise, is that he, like the rest of us, is waiting on Kawhi's decision. To me, like I think he's confident, and I reported about 2 months ago that he was confident, but I don't think he or the Raptors have any idea more than we do of what Kawhi is going to do.
We were just discussing Uncle Dennis. Can you give any insight to what this guy brings to the table? You've had to cross paths with him. He's clearly not LeVar Ball, where it's just off the charts. He's just around. He's Kawhi's guy. Do you have any insight on what he brings to the table or what he's all about?
Yeah, definitely a whole lot quieter than LeVar Ball. He kind of like Masai this year, he operates in the shadows behind the scenes, but more and more as the season went on, he was around. You didn't see him much the beginning of the season. I saw him around a few times, the preseason probably helping Kawhi get settled. But then this was something that we talked about a little bit. I think I mentioned when I was in studio with you guys towards the end of the season in the playoffs is that as the year goes on, you're seeing him around more. He was traveling with the team during the playoffs. He'd be the guy after wins in the playoffs that would be outside of the locker room, high-fiving guys, hugging guys, talking to Masai for a long time. And I can confirm, based on what I've heard, what I've seen, that Masai has built a really strong relationship with Uncle Dennis. I also like, by the way, today that he actually calls him, refers to him as Uncle Dennis. So that's important because we know, I mean, not only is that Kawhi's uncle, but he's incredibly influential in terms of the business decisions that Kawhi has made and probably will make going forward.
With Josh Lewenberg, our Raptors reporter, he was in the room for Masai Ujiri's season-ending press conference today that went just over an hour, and it was very optimistic, and Masai was in the mood to talk, and a lot of people inspired by what he had to say. But I had a bit of a different viewpoint in terms of the message I thought he was trying to portray today. It goes without saying, we all know he wants Kawhi Leonard back. But he understands that there's a real opportunity here and a real chance that Kawhi won't return. And if he doesn't return, then it's time for Masai to start getting out in front of this and spinning the PR. And I think he spent a large portion of the press conference today trying to convince people, even if Kawhi leaves, it's okay. Yes, it's a step backwards in terms of the talent. They're probably not going to win a title next year, although Masai's not going to put his name beside a statement like that. But I think he's trying to convince people, I've done this already once. I can do it again. We're not going back into the dark ages where guys are dying to get out of here and we're winning 28 games and we're bottoming out. That was the impression I got, was that, yes, Kawhi is the priority, but if it doesn't happen, it's not the end of the world, and put faith in me because I've done it before. Did you get that same read?
I did. And, I mean, it's not incorrect either in the sense that I think next season is a bridge season no matter what happens here. I mean, if the Raptors run it back and Kawhi re-signs, I mean, first of all, it doesn't sound like the option to sign a five-year deal and for Kawhi to go for that long-term security is really as realistic as it once was. It seems like the options here are like go to the Clippers, leave, or sign a short-term deal. A lot of people talking about a potential one-and-one deal, a one-year deal with a second-year option for Kawhi, which actually would make a lot of sense because it would line him up contractually with basically everyone else in this Raptors core. So why I think that would be interesting is you run it back for 1 year, you try and repeat as champions, compete for a championship next season, and after that, you essentially start from scratch. I mean, either Kawhi stays and you build around him, add new pieces, or re-sign the guys you have if they're still producing, you take another path. And then the alternative is if Kawhi leaves, you've got this core, Lowry, Ibaka, Gasol, Van Vliet for one more year. To your point, Brian, you probably run it back, if for no other reason than I think moving all those contracts, if you did decide, okay, let's start a rebuild here, I think that would be just too difficult. Mechanically, just it moving $30 million contracts, it's too difficult to do. So you run it back for 1 year, and after that, then yeah, Masai's in a situation where once again, he's got to go out and make bold moves. He has a lot of money to work with, a lot of roster spots to fill. I think that's probably what he's doing here, is getting ahead of it in both scenarios, is getting ahead of it because in a year from now, this team could look very different regardless of what Kawhi decides to do.